Thank you very much, Honourable Chief Minister. I now have the pleasure to invite the Minister of State of External Affairs, General B.K. Singh, to give us his special address.
Honourable Chief Minister Lal Tang Hawla, the Minister from Bangladesh, Nazrul Islam, all the MLAs and other eminent dignitaries who are present here, Senate's ke hierarchy led by Lieutenant General Johnny Mukherjee and Major General Arun Roy, all the eminent citizens who are present here, the universities which has hosted this seminar under the very able Vice Chancellor, Ambassador Srinivasan, and all the students who are attending this seminar, a very good morning to you. Namaskar, adab, and it's a pleasure to be in Mizoram. Actually, yesterday evening, something happened, and there was a chance that I would have missed coming here. And then I said to myself, last time I missed coming here, the CM remembered it and still remembers it, and I won't give him another chance to do that. So despite the problem in a little bit of walking, I said I must go and meet the Chief Minister and a very good friend, so that next time he understands that I'm always keen to come to Mizoram. Sanderski has chosen a very interesting and apt topic, Mizoram, the gateway, and I won't go beyond that, it is the gateway. The geostrategic location of Mizoram is such, where it borders Bangladesh, it borders Myanmar, and it is connected to all the other states through northeast. I'll come to connectivity part later, but otherwise it is very well located, and that was one of the reasons how Kaladan project started off after seeing how Mizoram is. India's policy of look east has undergone a change of act east in the last 2 years, and great amount of effort is being made. Since I'm no longer looking after the Department of Northeast region, I really don't know how much progress has been made, but being in the external affairs, we are monitoring the Kaladan project, and we are committed to ensuring very early completion of this project in the best possible manner. When we talk of connectivity, connectivity is not only how you connect to Myanmar and Bangladesh. Connectivity is also the back-end connectivity to other states and through them to rest of the country. The trilateral highway project is very much on track, and we aim to put down a definitive timeline on it very soon, so that it can connect through Myanmar to the highway coming from Thailand, which will enable our northeast region and Mizoram to connect to Bangkok, to Lao PDR, to Cambodia, and to Hanoi. The aim is that this highway will connect right from Bangladesh onwards to all the areas of Southeast Asia. It is our effort to see that this gets completed so that connectivity is available to Southeast Asia. But my main concern also is, how is the connectivity within the country itself? And that is what I think needs a great amount of attention, and the CM alluded to it very eloquently. The Ministry of Surface Transport is looking at it seriously. We are looking at how do we connect into both Manipur and Mizoram in terms of better road infrastructure, and subsequently how do we bring in the railway network into these two states. Because till the time you do not have connectivity which can take on container traffic from rest of the country to Southeast Asia and from Southeast Asia to rest of the country, the projects are not going to have much use. And when we talk of this connectivity, it will entail great amount of infrastructure development within Mizoram itself. You will need warehouses, you will need stopping places, you will have to create things which will be able to ensure that this trading activity can be managed not only on the road but otherwise too. So if you look at it in the futuristic point of view, you will find that Mizoram will have a very, very important role to play. And I think that has been in the minds of the people at Standard Scale to say that Mizoram is the gateway to Southeast Asia. When we look at our neighborhood, there are two things that stand out. Today, we have a political system in Bangladesh which looks very favorably at India. It is looking at how they can develop trade and business with India so that it benefits both the nations. Similarly, we have a political dispensation in Myanmar which is looking at India in a similar way, along with how it can carry this activity into rest of Southeast Asia. And therefore, interests of both the countries and India are aligned, which means that we can create business opportunities for our people and for people from both our neighbors in a manner in which it will benefit the rest of the community. Now, when you look at this milieu, you will find that Mizoram has a great scope to create opportunities within this which can be made use of by the people to create more employment, to create better systems which will be able to handle these things. A point that the Vice Chancellor had made was on entrepreneurship development. I fully agree with that. We need to have entrepreneurship development in Mizoram, and I would recommend that the university could probably tie up with the Entrepreneurship Development Institute in Gandhinagar to open a center here, which will help in ensuring that the capacity building can be done, where people can get a feel of what entrepreneurship development will be. Incidentally, the EDI, as it is called, has gone into very many countries in Africa and Southeast Asia. I'll be too happy to tell them to come here and meet you. One point that we need to look at very seriously is this back-end connectivity, how soon we can develop it. Because the way the road infrastructure is, at the moment, it is lacking. And we need to work very hard on it so that this back-end connectivity from the neighbors can be so developed that we are able to move heavy traffic, container traffic, onto these to whatever destination it is meant for. There is a great scope in the entire Northeast region. And I'm not just talking of Mizoram. Mizoram is the gateway, but everything will have to flow into Mizoram, which means that its connectivity with the rest of the states also has to be good in the Northeast. I'm quite sure the state has made its own plans. It has made its own plans for the type of infrastructure that they want. This, in conjunction with what is being planned by the central government, should become a source of a vision for the future, so that in a particular timeline, we are able to accomplish what we have set out to do. We are today constrained by the road network that exists right from Assam onwards, even up to coming up to Silchar is a problem. The road is not all that good. The road from Silchar is being extended via Ziribam to Imphal, and I'm quite sure the road will also get extended from Silchar onwards to Aizawl, and then it connects onto the Kaladan project roads, so that you get a better connectivity. Utilization of these and utilization in terms of what you need to create as infrastructure along these highways needs to be looked at, so that whatever land acquisition has to be done, whatever work has to be done in time slots, what resources to be garnered can be put down, and then when it starts materializing, you yourself will find how good it will become. I'm aware of the problems of land acquisition in Mizoram. We will have to find some solution which is both innovative and helps the people whose land it is. There is, as I look at it, there's going to be all-round development with Mizoram as the gateway, which will benefit people to a great degree. Now, people can reap the benefits only if they are made capable of taking care of this benefit, which means good education, which means capacity building, which means capabilities to be attained, which means skill development, so that for various things, people already are prepared to handle it. This may take, let's say, 5-6 years to come up, but these people who get trained can go in the rest of the country, utilize that experience and come back to handle it in Mizoram itself. So there is a great amount of future where our youth is concerned. And I would seriously urge the CM and all those who are present here to look at this aspect, because this is what is going to pay the state in the long run, and to all the youth whose capabilities can be harnessed, and the university can play a stellar role in this. One of the issues that has been pending for some time has been to bring the advantage of digitization into Northeast. There's a project on the anvil, at least it was when we last had the CM's conference as part of donor in Guwahati in 2014. I feel that till the time we do not bring the digital advantages into the northeastern states, we will not be able to utilize what we are looking at in terms of exploiting the connectivities that we would create. And this should ensure that Mizoram and rest of the northeastern states should become a model of how digitization can bring benefits for any future activity, be it trade, be it business, be it taking the tolls, be name a thing. It should all be so digitized that we should become examples and not what we always talk of as Singapore being the example. I think there's a great potential in Mizoram for doing that. The Chief Minister also alluded to hydro potential. There's a great amount of hydro potential that exists in Mizoram. which can not only make it self-sufficient in power, but they would be also able to sell this power to people who need it in other states as well as to our neighbors. I seriously feel that we need to exploit this and take this as far as is possible, so that we can this materializes in an early time frame, because all hydroelectric projects have a slightly long gestation period before the dams come up and all the areas get filled up with the water that you require for electricity generation. I also would like to touch upon two, three more things. Mizoram has got a rich culture. I think as gateway, this needs to be exploited. This will also ensure that more people-to-people contact and more tourism can be promoted in Mizoram. This is a great scope. This is a beautiful state. Like CM said, I think a lot of people don't even know about it. We need to very aggressively tell people that look here, this is a state which is like heaven. The army did some work on this by making a trilogy of Northeast, which at least now I'm trying to distribute it in my constituency, which is in the nearer the NCR, so that people can see how beautiful the land is, and some people will get encouraged to come here and spend some time. But at the same time, you also need to look at as to what kind of infrastructure you want to create. Is it just people are looking at large hotels, or is it that we can create smaller things and promote rural tourism? That this is something which the state will have to decide. But there's a great scope in tourism and culture where Mizoram is concerned. One thing which is becoming very relevant to the country as a whole and even in our neighborhood is the spread of terrorism. I think as part of our developmental model, we need to look at this issue as an entity which can affect our development. And therefore, measures need to be put in place which will enable us to curtail any disruption that can take place because of any terrorist activity. Terrorists know no boundaries. If you are doing well, you become a target. And a state which has been peaceful, a state which is on path of economic resurgence, I think it needs to look at this issue very seriously and quietly put into place measures which will ensure that no disruption can take place in its economic activity. I feel that this initiative by Sanerske to gather all of you, to seek your views, to also put across things which will make a difference to Mizoram and through Mizoram to rest of Northeast and its connectivity to the country has been an initiative which is worth applauding. I not only congratulate Sanders K for this, I also would like to congratulate our minister from Bangladesh for taking time out to come here and see how we can both as good neighbors promote things which will ensure that Mizoram's potential can be harnessed. Mizoram's potential can be taken forward and we can do things which will make a difference to this state and to rest of the country. I'm really impressed by the number of students who are present here. It's an opportunity students seldom get, despite the fact that so many people have gathered here and who have their own views. I think it will be a great idea if you can have more such events which will make a difference to the student community's comprehension of what they can do to make use of the future that is for Mizoram. With these words, I convey my thanks to all. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much, sir. Your words and thoughts are much appreciated. I'd like now to invite His Excellency, the Minister of Water Resources of Bangladesh, kindly to give his address.
Honorable Chair, Ambassador K. Srinivasan, who also served one tenure in Bangladesh in the late 80s. And when he left behind a lot of admirers there who fondly remember him. And later on, when he became the Secretary of Foreign Affairs, we in Bangladesh, we felt much better knowing that one of our own is sitting in the South Block and looking at Bangladesh most favorably. At this moment, he is chairing this session, and I personally feel very comfortable that even if I stray away from the main theme of the topic, the Mr. Srinivasan, as the chair, will not throw me out of this place. Seated on the this stage is someone I look upon very, very fondly, because I first met him when he was commanding the Eastern Command in Kolkata. When I was invited to come and attend the Vijay Divas celebrations, there we requested him for a big favor. I'm from the first Bangladesh war course, which was trained during the early phases of our liberation war in 1971. And we were trained by the Indian Army officers, who in a short period prepared us to face anything and everything, all odds in the battlefield. And I, with a lot of respect and gratitude, remember the professionality of those Indian Army officers who prepared us for everything. And we were trained in a place called Murti in Jalpaiguri district. So over the years, we never had the opportunity to come and revisit Murti, where we were made into warriors from young boys. So we requested the general to allow us to visit there. When he became the army chief, he presented us with a very big gift, which I'll remember all my life. He hosted my course, those who are still alive. We lost a few in the war and later on. And as his guest, we came to visit all those places. And the Indian Army, Eastern Command, hosted us as the guest of the Indian Army Chief. Thank you, sir. This is a personal gratitude from me and my postmates. I have also a gratitude to offer to you that you are a freedom fighter. Anyone who fought to liberate Bangladesh be it a Mukti Bahini or be it a valiant Indian Army, Navy and Air Force men and officers. We all honor them by calling them freedom fighters. And General Vicky Singh, as a very young officer, fought in our liberation war. Incidentally, General V.K. Singh and I, we were born the same year, 1951. There is a common bondage there also. Since I can't read what is written over here, it's so small letters, so I will speak whatever comes to my mind. My respect to the Honorable His Excellency, the Chief Minister of Mizoram, Mr. Lal Thanwala, under whose pragmatic guidance Mizoram is looking up at a new horizon, reaching out to the whole of India, rest of India, and looking out to the other states in the region. And he has already shown the Mizo people that a great future is waiting in front of all of them. Now, the topic, before I go, it will be very ungrateful of me if I did not mention General Mukherjee, who is instrumental for my coming here. It is he who invited someone to come from Bangladesh, and I was the fortunate guy to come. Coming to Mizoram has been a nostalgic visit for me, because 41 years before, in 1975, I was here for a couple of months in a place called Varangte, where the School of Indian Army School of Counterinsurgency and Jungle Warfare is situated. At that time, I made a short visit to Aizawl for a couple of hours. But what I saw at that time and what I see now, some people have been speaking that not much progress or not much development has been seen in these parts. But to me, visiting after 41 years, I saw a lot of progress. When I looked at Aizawl, on my way from the airport, I was absolutely awestruck seeing what a beautiful city it is growing up to be. And it must be the people of Mizoram who is doing it, because they love their capital. About connectivity, a lot of things have been said. No country or no people can grow and progress if they remain isolated. There has to be connectivity all around, reaching out to the neighbors, reaching out to the rest of the country is very important. And Mizoram, as it has been said, that it is strategically situated, not only as the southeastern state of India, also strategically located between Bangladesh and Myanmar. Bangladesh, connectivity all around, especially the northeastern regions of India, for us is very important. The government of Bangladesh now, under the leadership of our Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, it is a top priority that we open up to the northeastern region of India and create opportunity with them together for the development of Bangladesh as well as the northeastern region of India. So we are very eager, and this seminar where this aspect is being discussed by the experts here. Sorry, I didn't facilitate the expert participants and the distinguished gentlemen. I'm not a very good speaker, But I've seen General is much bigger, better a speaker because he has led the Indian Army. I am a politician who is a politician only for the last 7-8 years. So I am not also a political orator as they are, firebrand. So forgive me for my shortcomings. So like we were talking about connectivity, Bangladesh actually has tremendous potential to improve upon the connectivity of northeastern region with rest of India, especially West Bengal. Because we sit in between, as you'll see over there, Sena's map over there, their emblem, which is aptly very well designed, it shows that the location of Bangladesh, the blank place you all know. So for connectivity between mainly East Bengal and the northeastern regions of India, states of India, Bangladesh can provide that vital connectivity. Before, in the pre-partition days, actually connectivity between these regions were through Bangladesh. Now, after the partition, the things changed, and India now has to, people from West Bengal or goods from West Bengal has to travel all the way from the north through Assam and through a narrow corridor which we call the chicken neck. I don't know if the Indians call it, sir. So that narrow zone in the north of our country, does not have enough space for building more roads or railways and all that, improving upon the existing system. But Bangladesh can provide that space. And Bangladesh is very willing and ready to do that because we know what lies in the future and how we all can benefit from it. We have very good connectivity with some of the states in northeastern region, like Assam, Meghalaya, Tripura. But Mizoram is right there, beside our Chittagong hill tracks, and probably from Aizawl itself, our second biggest city and our biggest port, and the main commercial hub, Chittagong, won't be more than a couple of 100 kilometers. It is so near, yet so far. And interestingly, in the pre-partition days, the people of this region, their gateway to rest of India or the world or to Kolkata, for that matter, was through Chittagong, by rail or by sea. So Chittagong is still there where it was, only because of the partition and artificial boundaries, things have changed. Things have changed not for better, but has made more difficult. Connectivity has been made more difficult. In today's world, we understand that no progress, no development can take place if there is no peace. And thankfully, peace exists between these northeastern states with Bangladesh, or for that matter, in a bigger scope, with India as a whole. As a matter of fact, the bilateral relationship between Bangladesh and India has never been in greater heights after 1975. After that, 1975, for nearly 21 years, Bangladesh-India bilateral relationship was not very comfortably placed. Now, because of the pragmatic, forward-thinking vision of our Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina and Indian Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi, I'm very mistaken here. Narendra Modi, forgive me for this. Maybe I'm a little, in spite of Mr. Srinivasan chairing the session, I'm a little nervous. So, Mr. Narendra Modi. So, the two countries have achieved a new height of good relationship, neighborly feelings. And I think now, sky's the limit. Anything is possible between two countries as far as connectivity is concerned. We have already existing connectivity with all over India by air, by road, by rail, and by riverine to some extent, and the sea. We already, you see, the transshipment agreement has been worked out between Bangladesh and India, and of late, a lot of commercial and other sort of commodities of, reaching out to this part of India from other part through Bangladesh. And to mention, the oversized cargo or equipments of Palatana power plant in Tripura, these were transported by river to our Ashuganj river port and then transported by road to Agartala. And because of excessive rainfall, when the road communication snapped between these parts, especially Tripura, then humanitarian supply of 35,000 tons of rice was also done in the same route by the Indian government. So this shows that though the infrastructure in Bangladesh is not to the best of the standard to handle transshipment, but we are getting there. We are preparing ourselves and we are getting ready, like we are opening up more and more border customs and land ports. Vice versa, India is doing the same, reciprocating. So there are many points around Bangladesh from where Bangladeshis and Indians from these regions can travel to and from. Perhaps one of the most important and cheapest means of transportation and connectivity, which will boost connectivity, is on the sideline. That is the riverine transportation. In pre-partition days, Kolkata, which was at that time the main industrial base of India, at that time goods used to be transported by river from Kolkata to all the way to Assam in Guwahati, or all the way through Meghna and Barak River to Karimpur in India. Karimpur happens to be very close to Mizoram, only maybe some 60 or 70 kilometers from Mizoram border in close to Silchar. Our rivers, the main river system, three main river system, Ganga, Ganges, Brahmaputra and Meghna, GBM as we call it. These are three great mighty rivers. We have about 56 transboundary borders and 54 of them flows out of India to Bangladesh. And these three great rivers, we have little control on them because 93% of the basin is outside our country, mainly in India, and only 7% is in Bangladesh. Now, these three river systems are the highest silt-carrying rivers in the world. They carry transport about 1.2 to 1.5 billion tons of silt from the Himalayas into Bangladesh. Our rivers are badly silted up. It is a problem which is very expensive to deal with. But most important thing is we are growing the strength, the economic strength to deal with it. But we are also very thankful for this silt, because over thousands of years, Bangladesh, the land we live, our country, beloved country, was built by the silt from the Himalayas. So we also look upon the Himalayas more thankfully. Now, about these rivers. Now, our Prime Minister, she has a great vision. Because we all believe, all Bangladeshis believe, that the life of Bangladesh is our rivers. If our rivers do not survive, Bangladesh will not survive very long. So we have to look after our rivers, take care of them, so that Bangladesh can progress. So there is a great emphasis by our Prime Minister to dredge, re-excavate these rivers. Dredging is a very costly, financially as well as time consuming. It will take some time, but the preparation, I am very happy to let you know here that the preparations has begun in Bangladesh. We are building up our dredger fleet, procuring many dredgers from within Bangladesh. We have two very capable dredger manufacturing shipyards, and also from other countries. We try to collect some dredgers from India also under the credit line, but it has been slowed down because Indian shipyards have not probably built many dredgers. But we have invited a few companies, and we have requested them to participate in the tenders, and hopefully India will also participate in this great effort to dredge our rivers. Once we have done that, I have to again mention here something very important about Ganges Barrage, which we are planning for many reasons. It is not planning, in fact, the planning phase is over, even the design has been completed, and now we are waiting for the project to start. And this project, which will cost over $4 billion, will be implemented by a ministry where I work in, the Ministry of Water Resources. The main reason for building this barrage is that after the construction and operation of Farakka Barrage, the lean season flow of Ganges River has reduced drastically. We have ongoing 30-year treaty with India for sharing the Ganges water during the lean season in a very practical, pragmatic, and equitable manner. We get about 35,000 cusecs. And I am very pleased to inform you that the treaty is already 20 years old, 10 years more to go. We need to renegotiate it at that time. But for 20 years, the Indian authorities or the Indian government or the Indian people have not broken the pledges of that treaty for one day. This treaty is being honored with due importance, due honesty, and Bangladesh now gets, at least in Ganges, what water we are supposed to get as per the treaty. But yet, sometimes 35,000 cusec is not enough, so we have to build up a reservoir. The answer is the Ganges Barrage. Now, when we plan to build the Ganges Barrage, we will be creating the ponding area to the reservoir area in the river itself, backwards up to 185 kilometers, some about 30 to 33 kilometers down of Farakka Barrage. The waters will rise naturally because of the ponding, and out of 185 kilometers, out of 165 kilometers, half of it, about 183 kilometers plus, the river flows through a terrain where on one side is India, on the other bank is Bangladesh. After that, both bank is Bangladesh. So for this, we need India's cooperation. In fact, we want India to be a stakeholder in our project, and our Prime Minister has proposed this during the visit of Mr. Narendra Modi last 2015 June, when he visited Bangladesh. And he has responded very favorably. And maybe before I return to Bangladesh, a team will visit Bangladesh to discuss. We have provided with all the data to India for this barrage, because if they participate with us in it, then we know that this barrage and the project will be very, you know, strongly placed. Now, why we need this barrage? Because of the less flow of water, the southeastern region, which is one third of our country, Greater Khulna area, there is no water flow in those tributaries, those rivers. Same thing is happening in some parts of West Bengal and the Sundarbans in West Bengal, along with our Sundarbans, where because of almost no flow of fresh water from the Ganges into those tributaries, the salinity is, you know, pushing forward into the inland. This is happening in Indian part of Sundarban also. And our crop pattern and ecological balance is very badly disturbed in those areas where there was used to be lush green paddy fields giving us three crops. There is now only one crop. With Ganges barrage, we can flush those rivers, and the ecosystem in those areas will improve vastly. So will those parts affected by Farakka in the Indian territory. So this is a win-win situation for both our countries. Now, about the connectivity opportunity created by, that would be created by our Ganges barrage. Now, with increased water in Ganges, the navigability will improve, and in the barrage we are going to keep designed provision for large riverine ships to pass. We'll have boat pass. Then the Indian ports around Calcutta, which used to operate or used to thrive at a before partition, sending their goods to Assam and these parts of northeastern region, will be reactivated, and a much more cheap and reliable connectivity will be established between two sides. Not only that ships from Kolkata will also, you know, reach our Chittagong port without having to go on a longer route by the sea. Smaller boats can carry from Kolkata to even our Chittagong. Now, as I was saying, that we are so close yet so far. And as I also mentioned, that at one time traditional route out for people in this region was Chittagong. We have to reinvent that route, because as I said, that connectivity is with this part Mizoram is vital to us, and it is only a matter of time that this will happen, because the relationship between the two countries are in such a great height. And with that connectivity, Mizoram and northeastern states of India will connect with a market which consists of 170 million people in Bangladesh. your indigenous industries or other industries that will grow will do business in Bangladesh, because we will be getting those things at a much cheaper price that we import from other countries. Mainly, you know, your mineral resources, coal, oil. Incidentally, there is already a program for building a pipeline from Chittagong to the refinery at Numaligarh. Who are also, thanks to them, they are also co-participant here, co-organizer here. And this pipeline is virtually a reality very soon. At this moment, at this time, a delegation headed by a minister is negotiating this pipeline in Delhi. And before that pipeline is physically there, already Numaligarh refinery is delivering diesel to Bangladesh. They have done one consignment by rail, and the rail route will continue to be used till the time the pipeline is used. There is a project which is very close to final negotiation regarding setting up LPG plant in Bangladesh at Mohishkali, and that LPG will be by an Indian company. It would be on Indian investment, and that company will produce enough LPG to supply to Bangladeshi market and cover the requirements of Tripura state of India. So, a lot of things are already happening. And furthermore, I would like to say that we are opening up our Chittagong Hill Tracks, which is very close to Mizoram. Very close to Mizoram border, we have a small little town called Sajek, which was small but a thriving place in pre-partition days. And Sajek was the route into Bangladesh by the people from Mizoram. And we have already built the road, and it is again thriving as a tourist venue. And all it will need is a medium-sized bridge somewhere. The name of the river I don't really remember at this time. And people from IGEL will be able to reach Chittagong in a few hours once that happens. And we would very seriously hope that we are talking about it, and we make it happen, we make it materialize. Because that route will only not only give Mizoram and not some of the northeastern states access to our ports, our roads and our railways, our communication network, it will also give us a gateway through Mizoram into Myanmar and then on to China. So this is very vital for our development. Peace is probably the most important factor for any development, unhindered peace. As I said before, luckily we are in a region now which is very peaceful. And I was talking to His Excellency that at least I'm a believer. I believe that I don't see any conflicts between Bangladesh and India anytime in the future. So, because we have successfully negotiated and signed the land border agreement with India, and that means we have no dispute regarding our borders with India anywhere. And we have also successfully finished our agreement with India regarding the, you know, sea boundary as well. So we know where is India and where is Bangladesh, we know. So there is no conflict there. I would believe that we will always have peace. There is no reason to not to have. We have a few problems like, you know, fundamentalism, terrorism out of fundamentalism, which India looks upon as a very important issue and a serious threat. Likewise, Bangladesh has no difference whatsoever. In fact, both the countries are thinking absolutely in the same line, which is zero tolerance about this issue, and Bangladesh is never going to allow Bangladesh territory for any kind of terrorism or incursions into India. Do I have any more time? All right, okay. Once I get going. So I will finish by saying this much only, that we have spoken about connectivity a little bit, and we should look upon this riverine connectivity, which will boost all connectivities, and I know India is thinking very positively, but positively and quickly think about the Ganges Barrage, which can be a joint venture and another mark of India-Bangladesh friendship, which is physically there on the ground and will last for hundreds of years. We are there at Sajet. Come and meet us there, and we will open up rest of India and rest of the world for these parts, northeastern region, which is so rich with all resources and culture and everything else. And together we shall grow. Bangladesh, India, and the northeastern regions. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Thank you very much, Mr. Minister. I now request Lieutenant General Mukherjee, please, to come and give a vote of thanks to the speakers of this distinguished session.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pul Altun Hola, Honorable Chief Minister of Mizoram, on behalf of all of us, I'm more than half a Mizo, my wife is a Mizo. So on behalf of all of you, we'd honestly like to express our thanks because General Vicky Singh will not be with us after this. He'll just have lunch and then go back. So we are indebted to you, sir, for joining us today and taking so much of trouble. In fact, I don't think words can express our gratitude. Thank you for coming and thank you for being with us. But before I switch on further, I do have a request on behalf of the Mizo people. Number one, we put across the points of connectivity to you because Mr. Nitin Gadkari, we desperately wanted him to come, but he didn't come. So most of the connectivity problems, I'm afraid, relate to Delhi, not to the Mizo government. The second point is, with the connectivity, you've got a 50-meter stretch running all across Mizoram, deforested to make roads, wherever they're coming. And it is an environmental disaster. Though I haven't broached the subject yet with the Chief Minister, after going around, I honestly feel Mizoram needs one environmental ecological TA battalion for North Mizoram, another for South Mizoram, associated with the Assam Regiment, my regiment. And it would help a lot in reforestation, as also improving the ecology of Mizoram. And thank you very much, Mr. Muhammad Nazrul Islam, Member of Parliament, Bir Pratik, Minister of State for Water Resources, Government of the People's Republic of Bangladesh. We are indebted to you, sir, for coming. We are very grateful. I'd also like to thank Ambassador Ong, who will not be with us tomorrow. Gave us a wonderful talk, and Dr. Lee would be speaking to us in this afternoon, who've all come to us from abroad, as also Mr. Dipankar Chatterjee, because they'll not be here for the... I'd also thank the Honorable Chief Minister for putting across so frankly and so well an excellent talk on issues related to not only Mizoram but also to this seminar. Thank you very much.
We have extended the lunch break up to 2:45, but please be seated by 2:45. Once again, up to rows 8 from the podium.
Come back after lunch. We start the session number 4 on connectivity and sub-regional cooperation. This session will be chaired by General Mukherjee. I would request Mr. John Ramuvia and Mr. Jitendra Chaudhary to please come on the dais.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The VIPs have gone and so have the rest, but I'm sure they'll come back soon. This is session 4, a very, very important session on connectivity and sub-regional cooperation. Our two speakers are Mr. John Ramuvia, the Chief Engineer National Highways of Mizoram, and the second speaker is Mr. Jitendra Chaudhary, Honorable MP and Chairman of the Tripura Industrial Development Corporation. Mr. Chaudhary was the right-hand man of Mr. Manik Sarkar at all times and has actually led the way to Tripura's industrialization. Over to the Chief Engineer.
Respected Chairman, General Mukherjee, dignitaries, friends, students, all have come here to attend this seminar. It is a pleasure for me to have been given time to talk about the state of connectivity in Mizoram and the region. Especially from the perspective of the state government of Mizoram.
They can't hear anything with the issues they are saying.
Initially, I had been asked to give a general knowledge of the national highway connectivity we have in the state. But on seeing the subject of this meeting. I'll go through all the works that we do on national highways and see and discuss each road as to how it can help in becoming the gateway to Southeast Asia. I'll go through the slides briefly. Please concentrate on the slides. These are a general list of what to do as an agency of the Ministry of Road, Transport and Highways. We do consultancy for road construction. We do the construction and we do the maintenance, different types of maintenance. At present, we have about 11 numbers of national highways, very long ones, about more than 500 kilometers, short ones like 8 kilometers only. The first highway I'll talk about is National Highway 54. This is the lifeline of Mizoram. It starts from Assam in the north, goes right through the heart of state and ends at Pipa in the South Mizoram in Sihar district. Being the lifeline, it goes through 6 districts in Mizoram. Also, all other national highways in Mizoram branch off from this highway, which will come out afterwards. As I said earlier, we have this road goes through 6 districts and goes through 4 district capitals. To connect the other 2 district capitals, we have a short road called NH54A, which connects Lungmei town to this highway, and again National Highway 54B, which connects NH54 to Sihar district capital Sihar. The next road is those were internal roads. Now this is a interstate road which connects Mizoram with Tripura on the west. It connects Tripura, and as said before, this could be one of the roads which could go through from Kolkata to Bangladesh, on to Mizoram, and then on to Myanmar on the east via another road, another actual, which I'll come to later on. As you can see, I've given some details of works we're doing. This is the multimodal road. It is NH502A, commonly known as the multimodal road. It is, this road starts at Longtai, connects to Kolkata through the road which we are exiting in Mizoram portion. The Mizoram portion road is about 90 kilometers or so. And here you see how it is a multimodal transport road. It connects Kolkata to Akyab, situated seaport in Myanmar, by sea road of about 540 kilometers, and then follows a river route for about 158 kilometers, land route in Myanmar about 100 kilometers, and in Mizoram, the new multimodal transport road of about 91 kilometers. This is a map showing the salient features of the road. As you can see, from Kolkata to Sitwe port, this is the sea road. From Sitwe to Kaletwa is a river route, and from then on it is land route by road. Overall, the route is shorter up to Aizawl by about 375 kilometers. But what we have to also consider is that the majority of the road is by water transport, which is much, much cheaper than road transport. The period of transportation will be about the same whether we go through Guwahati or we go through a river route, the multimodal route. Now this is NH150, which connects Mizoram with Manipur. I have not said before, all our roads, all NH in Mizoram, except for some portions between Konpui, Buichili and Sairam Lane Pool, are 2 lane roads. All the others are single lane roads. This is also a single lane road. This is being considered for 2 laning, some this year and the remaining portions subsequently later on. The next road we consider is NH154. This connects Dilpakir in Mizoram to Assam. The importance of the road cannot be seen from the map. You have to understand that there are clashes between different communities, between the communities of people in Silchar and Mizoram, due to differences in opinions in some various matters. In those cases, there is a tendency of some communities to blockade roads, like NS54. In those cases, this gains importance as giving us alternate route to Assam and to other things which are not yet blockaded. The next highway is another highway, is one connecting Mizoram to Manipur. This is a newly declared road. Declared due to the request of Manipur state government, so that whenever they face blockades in the north connecting to Nagaland or to the west connecting to Assam, Silchar, they use this route to get all their essential commodities, goods through Mizoram from Silchar side. So this route has been approved for becoming national highway. There is another route which is recently declared as a national highway. This one is again declared as national highway due to request of Manipur government, whereby when they go through Mizoram towards Silchar, the route for them is quite short. This requirement is again due to blockades held by communities in Nagaland or in West Manipur. So this is a new national highway which has been recently declared. We have not started any work so far yet. National Highway 6. This starts from Siling and ends at Champai on Myanmar border. This is one of the roads which I had spoken previously, where land route from Kolkata can go to Myanmar through Dhaka, Tripura, Mizoram, and then on to Myanmar. This has been recently declared national highway. No work has been taken up yet, but feasibility studies have been completed. More or less completed right now, so that it can be made in double lane and usable immediately. This is a national highway which connects Lunglei district and NH54, the lifeline of Mizoram, to Bangladesh border for trade purposes. It ends in the border of Bangladesh at Labung, or more specifically Korpuiswa, where there are land customs stations, etc., proposed for construction for border trade. These are some of the safety works being done to make our roads safe. What I would like to say is that when we look at the national highways, we can look at it in the perspective of the local communities which use the road, and again overall to see how these roads can be used as a gateway to Southeast Asia. Here I would like to say that we have a few roads, namely this 302, which connects Bangladesh. I would desire that the other portion of the road in Bangladesh also be taken up by Bangladesh government, so that there is a free communication for people and for trade. Another is NH6. This goes right into Myanmar, but the portion from Ri to Salam and all those places are not yet up to the mark. They are not even single lane, if I'm not wrong, single lane trackable road. If that can be developed from the Myanmar government side and be developed on this side, this could be a very good trade route and through route for people from Bangladesh as well as Northeast states. Also, this multimodal transport project road. This has been spoken about quite a lot today. The progress seems to be very slow for this thing as well as for National Highway 44A. But we have to understand that the progress is slow due to various reasons such as land acquisition, environmental matters, which cannot be just hurried up from our side. Could be that coming, however, we are making the best of the time that we have and try to finish it as listed here. So the gateway to the north, to South Asia from Mizoram may be seen from this map. Yes. On the east, we can connect to Myanmar via Aizhou, Selim, Champhai Road. Again, we can connect to Myanmar and other countries in Southeast Asia through waterways, roadways and waterways. We connect to Bangladesh on the west via Lunglai, Klabung, Kortuswa Road, and to some extent using NS44A, which goes through Lianhui Airport, which you can see I have marked the airport on the map, small symbol of aeroplane. That road could go through Tripura by land on to Bangladesh also. So these are the things, these are the roads that we can develop. Multimodal road is being made into two lane. NS44A, the central portion from Aizhou to multimodal road and beyond, are two lane, single lane right now, and is being upgraded to two lane road by NHIDC using JICA funding. The remaining portion of NH54A from Silchar to Aizhou is also being proposed for two laning this year. So these are the national highway networks that we have, which connects to our neighboring states and which can potentially connect to our neighboring countries and be useful as gateway to Northeast Asia. Those are the roads we have. I hope I'm clear. All the information I provided on the right side, they are information purposes, which I made for information about those national highways. I will end my presentation here. Any questions? Maybe ask now or maybe tomorrow in the final session. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. John Ramoya. I now request the Honorable MP from Tripura Mr. Jitendra Chaudhary to kindly make his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, General Mukherjee, Mr. Romaya, His Excellency Mr. Islam, Honorable Minister from Bangladesh, all other dignitaries of the dais, and friends, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, first of all, I'd like to thank Seners and Mizoram University for initiating this kind of the dialogue. It is not only for Mizoram, I think it is required for the entire Northeastern region. So my topic is connectivity and sub-regional cooperation between Mizoram Tripura with Bangladesh and Myanmar. This morning we heard very eloquent speeches and also presentations from different experts, and very particularly from the Honorable Chief Minister and our Honorable Minister of State, External Affairs, Mr. B.K. Singh, and also our guest, Mr. Islam. My presentation, instead of going all this vision further, repeating all this, I will give you some what on the ground we are doing, and on the ground it is really possible. Of course, it will not be what in the morning we heard, it will not contradict to that. So you know about this Northeastern region, that 98% of our border, it is international border. Only 2%, 22 kilometers, the chicken neck, it is connected with the rest part of the country. And this Northeast India, it is gateway of Southeast Asia, and it was, but that was that gateway, how it could function fast and function effectively, that we have to see in the future. And as you know about this region, that rich in biodiversity, hydrocarbons, and so many other potentialities in our region, and it can be a powerhouse. Now the locust or act is, if really it could be implemented that way, from this northeastern side we can be connected with the southeast and the far east Asia. So that's way, in this part of the country, this can be a powerhouse for the entire country, international. Then I just like to give you a brief profile. Of course, you are all in the know about this, that about the land. Tripura is only 10,492 square kilometer, mostly hilly and terrain, and Mizoram it is 21,087 square kilometer hilly. Of course, though it is hilly and terrain, both the states endowed with the all natural resources. An international border we are having Tripura, 856 kilometers, 8 districts, and Mizoram 722 kilometers, as you are all in the know. Then our population, Tripura is having 37 lakh population. Now our literacy rate is, according to the latest, the 8th September this year, latest declaration, it is 97.22%. And Mizoram, it is according to the NIC, I think it should be more than this 98.85%, I do believe. Then both the economy of the both the state is primarily agrarian, and of course the natural resources, both what Tripura we have, what that you in Mizoram also, you have the same, and the potential is all for this agro-horticulture, ecotourism, information technology, etc. Because of our high literacy and English-speaking population. Then Tripura, I am talking about, since my topic is like Tripura, so I am giving some details about Tripura. Then already we have established that kind of relation with the Bangladesh. We are having 7 land customs stations with Bangladesh, and out of 7, those 6 land customs stations, export and imports are going on, and there are 2 border huts. This border huts is very, very encouraging, and by the border huts, the grassroots people, even the local producers, the agriculture, the farmer community, they are also being benefited out of this border huts. And that is that border huts, not only in terms of the economy, in terms of the business, that the relation between the people to people relation between Bangladesh and India, it is being strengthened up. And now out of this experience of these 2 border huts, not only in Tripura with Bangladesh, also there are 2 border huts from Meghalaya border. Now our border security forces, those who are meant for the border, guarding the border, they are recommending that more such border huts should come up. Why? Because it does not only bring the, enhance the economy, enhance the livelihood, also it helps out to maintain the peace, tranquility and law and order, etc. Then the strategic location of Tripura, you know, from 3 sides. From 3 sides you see, this is Tripura from 3 sides to Bangladesh, 856 kilometers. And official trade with Bangladesh, it has started in 1994-95. Then efforts of border hut, I have already talked about this. And also the Siragang port, from this is our end and Siragang is here. Really, the distance is only 32 kilometers and the surface distance is 72 kilometers. So if this can be connected, now up to the end of the border, broad-gauge train is going and already national highway is there. If it is further developed, then it can be extended up to the Chittagong. Then that can be the another road to access the Chittagong port. And it can be a road for inter-northeastern region. Then again, this you see Agartala is here. Now the transport, the goods, etc. have to go through this to Kolkata. What distance we have to cover? If that access at this time, Islam has in the morning, it told that Bangladesh is agreeable, and not only agreeable, they have already acted upon it. Our Palatana power project, it could not have come up unless Bangladesh has supported to us, attended their cooperation to us. We are really, really very much grateful to Bangladesh. And now, if that transit can happen, so it can be directly, it will be almost 1/4 for the length we have to cover this time. And also, this length is only, it is only 72 kilometers. Then the trade between the Bangladesh and Tripura. Here one thing, from Bangladesh side, always there has been a complaint that the trade balance is tilted towards India. Of course, India having the big volume and there are number of things produced here. And I think the 1% of the India's total, the import is coming from Bangladesh only. So there, but from Tripura side, and it must be with other northeastern states also, you see the export to Bangladesh, this is the scenario. This is the export from Tripura to Bangladesh. still, since we are all having only unprocessed thing, no value addition is there. That's why our export to Bangladesh is very less, but import from Bangladesh is very high. That is, whatever the trade deficit with the India, Bangladesh can really, that can be compensated if that kind of connectivity and relation can be developed, not only with Tripura, also with all other states in Northeastern region. Then investment opportunities, there are so many things, I am not have this going through it. So the solar, and they are now in our state, there are some kind of the construction materials, because the PVC pipe, steel, timber poles, conductors, etc. If it has to come from the mainland, the transport cost, etc., the cost go high. So that's why our construction materials, particularly cement, we are procuring from Bangladesh. So that way, Bangladesh can be benefited if that kind of the under PPP model or somehow that can kind of the investment can take place, and or their products can be exported to Tripura and Northeastern region. So that way, the potential is there. Now regarding bamboo, one thing I like to say that of course the Northeastern region, not only Tripura or Mizoram, our bamboo resources, the China, the amount of the bamboo resources they have, the similar amount of bamboo resources India also we have, and the Northeastern region we are having the more than 2/3 of the resources. But today out of bamboo, where China more than 1,000 billion economy they are making, where is the place of our share of our India? Only 2%. So if that kind of industry, it can be have here, of course when connectivity, other thing will happen, it will come up, investment will grow. That way it can generate more employment, and also our local resources based industry could come up, and it will help our economy, and also out of our natural resources we can make all this kind of industry sideways at the employment. Then the proposed developments from Tripura side, I'm saying once again that the access to Siragan port by road and rail, already that agreement has been signed between the two countries. Now it has to be acted upon. Construction of bridge over Feni River, because one natural the boundary by river, that is disconnected between the two, the country. So now MOTS, they have sanctioned the project. Then Ashurganj port as port of call, and there also we need that from Ashurganj to Agartala, that road is constructed. And already our essential committees, etc., when our national highways blocked, that time we have been receiving the all goods from good that side. And Agartala Akhauda rail link, and for that also land acquisition, etc., has been already completed. And very recently our railway minister, Mr. Suresh Prabhu, and Bangladesh railway minister both came, and the foundation stools have been laid. I think it will be start within a short. And more border huts, as I said earlier. Now opportunities with Mizoram. Mizoram itself has a rich variety of horticulture. Then so many other things, the bamboo resources, high literacy rate, very much potential for the IT industry, bamboo fisheries, and so many things that can be here, which can be we can offer to the neighboring countries. Then this connectivity, which in the morning we have heard from several speakers, sees this Kaladan, what have been talked about, then this through the Tamu, etc. If really it comes up, then the entire scenario of the Northeastern region, not only these two states or Mizoram alone, entire region will be benefited. And now this morning also from so many speakers we have heard about the insurgency, so and so. Why this insurgency? Because of the unemployment. So If we are to combat this, we are to address the situation not by deploying more and more battalions, but by more and more investment and more this kind of the infrastructure to be developed. This trade with Mizoram and between Mizoram and Myanmar, you know better than me. So what are the information I have gathered, only I have mentioned here, that there are so many things in the neighboring country, in Myanmar, they are producing there, but and they have the surplus. And some items within the northeastern region, it is a deficit. So it can easily, if this connectivity could come here, and it will definitely put halt to the price rise, other thing, our people in northeastern region, we can be benefited out of that. Then area of cooperation, that since ethnically, culturally, very similar in the other side also. So in all these sectors, infrastructure development, agriculture and food processing, handicrafts and loans, manufacturing industry, etc. In both the sides, it could be a win-win situation between these two regions. Then also the collaborative, the investments that they are in Myanmar, there are the plenty of the pulses and other thing they are producing. But the processing unit, as I have gathered, as such, it has not been developed there. So our Indian company, from this side, not only from the northeastern region, from our Indian companies, they can go and there to flourish their agri-economy. In so many things, we can collaborate to the Myanmar. So, this way, not only the Mizoram or Tripura, if that kind of connectivity with the China, Myanmar, Bangladesh could develop, so that way what I said, the entire northeastern region, that could be a powerhouse for the economy, for the entire country, and automatically, we need not to ask the our investors of the West to look at the East, to look at the Northeast. Automatically, they will come here and find the opportunities, and this kind of the unlimited opportunities are lying in this region. So we can really dream of it, and it can be acted upon. So regarding connectivity, a lot of things have been talked about. Regarding the Kaladan multimodal project also, expert people have already spoken. So I would like to go again to that. So now, the weaknesses and opportunities. What is the weaknesses? The infrastructure development at more rate to facilitate sport trade. Also the infrastructure we heard with this Myanmar border with this Mizoram. And there also, with Tripura side also, there are, though there are seven land customs stations and one integrated check ICP, but still the infrastructure, road, other thing has to be developed. Then there in the borders, still, not only in More, the official and actual rate of access. This morning, Mr. General Mukherjee was saying that 75%, Dibanga Chatterjee was saying, 75% of the Indian community is going through informal route. So why it is happening? Because that kind of infrastructure and official exchange, that establishment has not yet set up there. So once that is set up, not only it will turn to the economy, turn to the revenue, and also that many more people will be attracted to this job. So this is the weaknesses we have to really work on, and the opportunities. This Kaladan multimodal, the transport project, transshipment facility to Chittagong and Bangladesh, linking of Manipur More by rail, transit trade with through Bangladesh to through Myanmar to 7 10 Asian countries, and act this policy. This morning, number of speakers told, I like to little differ with them, that they are saying that money is not dirt. I am being a member of parliament and had been the minister in Tripura state more than 20 years, handled so many departments. What is my experience? Yes, they are the, talked about the non-lapsable pool of central sources. What is the status of that? Present government or previous government, there, if we talk from the very beginning, more than 20,000 crores should be with the non-lapsable pool of central sources. Whether these are available? No. No ministry, either donor or either finance, are ready to answer about this. Then again, now the NEIIPP in Tripura, when I left the cabinet, there more than 12 companies have set up their stretch other thing. They are about to commission their projects. But unfortunately, in one fine morning, one order has been issued that the NEIIPP, it has been suspended without having any time frame, and still it is suspended. So there, of course, I am not differing that there is money. India being a big country, money is not a dart. But what is dart? The policy. By not only rhetorical statement, locust or actis, really it has to act. Unless that act and have the consultation with the civil society and government of the Northeast, nothing could be done. So that's why there are projects, there are no doubt of the ideas. Ideas are there. So many, from not only from this kind of these seminars, ideas are poured, ideas are given by so many people. But to materialize that idea, that the correct or the required kind of the policies required, that policy should be negotiated by the different ministries. One ministry is saying this thing, another ministry is saying this thing. There is the problem. So there should be one very dynamic and very powerful ministry, not donor like. Donor really has become donor like. Donor does not have any choice. So unless this kind of various cannot be removed, this thing will not happen. But of course, potential is there, and it can be materialized, and it is possible, and really this region really can be made a powerhouse. This is my presentation. I think this seminar today and tomorrow, it will help us further to concretize and also to make our people aware, to make our people convinced that Northeastern region really deserves development, and really this can be happened, the potentialities we have. Thank you very much. Kalome.
I think on behalf of you, I must congratulate both speakers for excellent presentations. We're very grateful to you, sirs. I have only 2 points to add. One is with reference to Mizoram's roads. I have a suggestion to both the PWD and the state government. Mizoram has a tremendous advantage over other states that you have a very well organized civil society. Funds are difficult to come by, particularly for maintenance. For capital projects, funds always get available. But for maintenance, funds are limited. Particularly in a state like Mizoram, which is hit by heavy monsoons, as we've been. We're still getting hit, and you have a landslide every second day. So my suggestion to you is, please put the villages through the civil society on the job to keep the grass cut and keep the drains open. The grass cut and the drains open. Half your problem of landslides is due to the drains getting blocked. Please do that, and let PWD use their resources of the maintenance funds for repairing the roads and removing the landslides. That is suggestion number one. And organizations like YMA and all are tremendous. They have the capability to bring civil society together to do this. The second point was that I'm not going to take any time because I had actually separated session 4 and 5 because they were becoming too many speakers. They're actually the same subject. So we'll take on questions and answers at the end of session 5. And it will all be related to connectivity, transborder cooperation, and sub-regional cooperation. Thank you, sir, very much. Over to the next session. If I could request Shubhir to come up to chair the session. I'd also like to thank Honorable Mr. Jitendra Chaudhary. He's leaving us tomorrow. He will not be here with us tomorrow, for joining us and giving us his tremendous views on the subject. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.